Hi. Having looked at customer whale curves and looked at different peak profits for in that Venn diagram in the just the previous video clip, we can now start to ask some power law customer-centric questions. These are about growing our business because we have customer-centric strategies as opposed to what products can we promote next week and what manufacturer is giving us spiffs to our channel loading programs and what kind of deals do we have at our big show or something like that. We look at the ranking report, and first of all, we look at the five most profitable customers and think, holy smokes, we can't afford to lose those. And maybe one, two, three of those guys are all sort of birds of a similar feather, and that sort of leads us down a path of what I call customer nichenomics, which we'll look at in the next section of this video series. But certainly, the best defense is a good offense, and how do we take these guys to the next level so we don't lose them? But that kind of blinds us a little bit to realizing that it's one thing to be big and stable and profitable, but there are still 4% or less of our customers who are marvelously innovative and very disciplined and strategically smart, and they are growing four times faster than their industry average type of thing. And or there's some people who are industry consolidators because they have a financial approach. In other words, they buy people up and merge them in and run them better kind of thing. Two examples in drugstores. Walgreens pioneered big box standalone super drugstore facilities and grew organically, whereas CVS out of Rhode Island basically went and bought up regional chains and created a national chain or brand, and both have been successful. In either case, if we had been a supplier to those guys and married them, then they would have grown us, and the people that they put out of business, we weren't selling them, perhaps, and so that's a good thing. So ideally, we'd like to find five of these consolidators who are in our niche. But the net present value of their potential net profit stream over the next 10 years, discounted back to the present, is absolutely huge. In fact, it's not unusual to find that 80% of the future profit growth that could come from a given niche of customers comes from these 4% gazelle kind of people. So we need to know who they are so everybody in the team can hyper-focus on them and give extra flexibility, emergency, you name it, kind of service. And then lastly, we want to look at the very few exceptional big guys. Now, it doesn't have to be 5, 5, and 5. It could be, 2, 3, and 7, or, 10, 10, and 10, or whatever you want. But the idea is let's have some small, very hyper-focused approach to these three big leverage opportunity areas. With the big losers, of course, the goal is to turn a lose-lose relationship into a win-win and then get more SOC, a share of customer. Now, we can do this because of a couple secrets. First of all, one secret is that partners for wholesalers mirror our activity costs more or less on both the buy side and the sell side. So if we have a lot of transactional activity costs with a supplier, that makes a supplier unprofitable for the volume or SKU pick activity we're doing, then typically the manufacturer is going to reflect those costs also. And on the customer side, same thing. So if we could just have a P&L for a losing customer or a P&L for a losing supplier, we can go out and present them with this and say, look, best we can tell, this is what's going on, and look at all of our activities and tell me you don't have these kinds of activity costs on their side of the fence. So what can we do to find some new way of doing business where we reduce both sets of activity costs? It's a free lunch. That certainly is a very different conversation than win lose, give me a price cut on the buy side or try to sneak up our margins on the sell side. And what we'll also find, secret number two, is most of these dysfunctional relationships, these big losing relationships, happen or have happened in other channels, and sometimes other channels have come up with structural remedy solutions for them, and we can actually go find those, borrow them, and adapt them to our situation. What we'll find out is when it comes to turning around losing relationships, It's the huge reduction of huge buy-sell friction that's far, far greater than trying to renegotiate the price, either down on the buy side or up on the sell side. There's no way we're going to raise prices 20% on a super losing account to break even. We're going to figure out how to reduce the cost to serve and their hidden costs by 22%. Then the last question is, what's the upside of untapped core intersection, which is the most profitable items sold to our most profitable customers? And right now we'd assume, well, we're getting it all. And that's tantamount to saying all of my salespeople are able to go out and get equally large share of the big accounts they call on, which we know is just not true. It also would suggest that because we're in the box of saying, well, we have good service, not distinctively great service, we can't get, quote, the lion's share of the transactional game in every case, let alone open the door to being able to say, hey, you were so distinctively better than anybody else, let's get married and work on win-win supply chain solutions. So that's going to be the big upside there. The problem is that all takes extra energy and effort and focus. And right now we're so busy taking care of mistakes and screw-ups and misunderstandings with the bottom 80% of our customers who are break-even or small losers, we're distracted. So there are two sides of a coin, which is what's the upside opportunity of renewing our core, selling more profitable items, more the most profitable customers. But the other side is we have to free up resources from the huge distraction of selling lots and lots of chronically small, they're not growing, break even or losing customers because our service model and pricing doesn't fit the margin dollars they can buy. So those are some power law customer centric questions. Also, I might add, if you go to merrifield.com, click on exhibits and go to exhibit 44. There's this huge 30-page, what I call 555 kit. So you can knock yourselves out with that if you want to go much deeper in the ideas that were raised in this particular tutorial. Thank you.